yes, it's a church, and yes, we're sort of here to worship, because today I'm meeting a Hollywood legend, the king of the action flick, and owner of the longest and biggest name in the movie world, Arnold Schwarzenegger. In his new blockbuster, End of Days, the forces of evil are taken on by cop Jericho Kane, played, of course, what's where you're going? I'm trying to do a thing here. Played, of course, by Arnold. And here he is.
Please, God, help me. Give me strength.
1,000 years, you have awaited my return. Behold, you have failed.
Take it easy. We are the good guys.
They tried to kill me. Why?
She's been chosen.
Chosen for what?
If the Dark Angel consummates your flesh with this human body, then he unlocks the gate of hell.
The Dark Angel is loose!
How can you expect to defeat me when I am forever and you are just a man?
Hello, good to see you.
Good to see you. Coming to the church. What a place to go, isn't it? We built this, do you know what? We built this specially for you. Oh, see that.
Look at this.
I know, what a reception.
Great looking audience, I like that.
They're a good looking bunch, aren't they?
Oh, look at this, the women.
There's a lot of the women.
Yummy for the tummy.
The women, nice. There's women there, there's bodybuilders.
There's everything here.
Okay.
And some really good friends from way back. Camera one, stay on them. Anyway.
Well, Jim, we've been talking to those legends
exactly,
in the show. Perhaps you'll wish you hadn't encouraged us to talk to those. They might have spilled the beans.
That's
Do you know
okay.
what? In one word only, how did a small town boy from Austria become one of the most famous people on earth?
Why do you want me to say it in one word?
One word, Arnold.
I don't stay with your rules. Dream.
Dream.
Dream. I was poor because I didn't have anything. I had no money, I had no things, we had no TV, we had no refrigerator, we had nothing as kids. But I was rich because I had a dream.
You had a dream.
I had a dream of becoming the greatest bodybuilder, and I had a dream to use bodybuilding as a means to get into films. But I had no idea that it would go as far as it did, that it would go beyond the body roles, beyond the muscles, and then do movies like Terminator, Predator, End of Days, and stuff like that. That was like, you know, I had to kind of reinvent my dream after I achieved that.
Okay, but this dream, I mean, of bodybuilding, we'll come to that, but there must have been a time in your life before that when you didn't have any thoughts of bodybuilding at all. What sort of child were you?
Well, I grew up in Austria. I was born after the Second World War in 1947. It was poverty, there was no food around, no, really nothing, and I think that was the reason why I developed such a tremendous desire, a desire to get out of there, and a desire to make it in life, to achieve big things. And then when I learned in school later on about America and about the skyscrapers, the big freeways, the big cars and all that, I said to myself, you know, I want to be part of this big thing.
At what point then did you start bodybuilding? How did that start? I read that at one point you looked at yourself in the mirror and you looked at your form and you thought, in order to be all in proportion, I must have 20-inch arms, which is wider than my legs. Which kind of seems, you know, I thought I wasn't having it at 15. Well, I mean, just talk us through that moment, which is actually the most crucial moment almost in your life when you decided, I want to be a bodybuilder. How did that come about, that day?
Well, it was, you're talking about when I looked in the mirror.
Yeah.
And I looked at myself naked. And as I looked down and I said to myself, this is all out of proportions.
I do the same thing myself.
Yeah, I'm sure you do. Yeah, exactly. So I said to myself, since I was a man of perfection and of symmetry, it was very important to me to build the rest of the body up to that level. And then eventually, after 10 years of training, I got to that level where I really felt, so now there's the perfect situation, perfect body, the symmetry was right and all that stuff, yeah.
Okay, because your parents, I gather, were quite disappointed because they actually wanted you to be a footballer. Is that right?
Well, I mean, it's natural when you're a young kid and you're 15 years old and you say to your parents that you want to be the greatest bodybuilder in the world and you're going to eventually become a movie star and a millionaire. You know, they have a tendency of taking you to the shrink, you know, the psychiatrist, yeah, well, I mean, and they analyze you, you know, your mind and what's going on up there. Maybe you're very sick,
yeah,
you know, and they were just, you know, going, walking away.
Yeah,
like this.
Bet.
Oh, poor boy.
I'm worried about our kid. He wants to build himself up and go to Hollywood, you know. What can we...
Exactly.
So it's very unusual then amongst
very
your contemporaries.
Everyone was basically, you know, laughing at me, at those ideas, and which was okay for me because there was one thing that I had, and that is a very clear vision of my goal.
But it seems odd. I mean, sorry to break in, but it seems very odd for someone that young to have such targets. I mean, ones that at the time would be just ludicrous, and to actually stick to them. I mean, did you think at the time you felt different to other people? Did you feel you were destined for greater things?
Well, I think whenever you do greater things, it's unusual. It's strange, it's weird. I mean, you know, that there are very few people in the world that does what you do. If you would have told your parents when you were a kid, that's what I want to do, I'm sure your parents would have said, I mean, I don't know your parents, but I mean, they would have said, you know, honey, why don't you just go to school and relax and do your homework and don't talk about those kind of things.
Yeah, but, I mean, you know, read your Bible, son.
Exactly.
Yeah, right.
So, you know, it's always odd for a parent. It's the same, you know, when I'm sure if my kids come to me and say to me something odd like that, I maybe would react as a parent like that.
Okay. What sort of food were you eating daily at this time? Do you remember the kind of intake to get that?
Well, I would say that normally, you know, you're required to eat high-protein foods, but if that's easier said than done. You know, in Austria, I mean, you know, we had once a week meat in my family because there was not the money available. So I had once a week, you know, some sausages or something like that. Like I remember one of my relatives that was in America sent over skim milk product, skim milk powder. After the Second World War, my mother stored all those cans, and so I used those cans. They had like 40% protein. So I made protein drinks with that, mixed it with milk and raw eggs and all those kind of things. The kind of mixed drink that you see in a movie in the beginning and end of days,
actually. Oh, that's the most disgusting drink I've
But that's the way it was. Then we put some liver pills in there and stuff.
You even liquidized pizza in a drink and
exactly,
no one knows that.
Exactly, yes, and yogurt and Pepto-Bismol and all those kind of things. Even
I thought
cigar.
That was genius, actually, putting the indigestion thing in a drink that's going to give you indigestion. I thought that kind of worked.
Just in case.
Yang there, yeah.
Just in case there's indigestion.
Say breakfast is the most important meal of the day.
Oh, I'm good.
There's going to be a lot of people watching this show. It's getting near Christmas. We're about to get a time of the year when we all really overindulge ourselves.
Yeah, that's what you call confidence. There'll be a lot of people watching. This is an enormous rating, guys.
It's a massive.
This is the biggest rating we've ever had.
It's the biggest rating
because you're on it, Arnold.
Yeah,
like
you're on it, Arnold.
Confidence. You see, that's what makes you great.
Don't knock it. Do you know what? There's going to be a lot of people watching this. Millions. throughout the world.
Absolutely.
We've got a global audience for this, and they're all going to be overindulging themselves over Christmas. They're going to be drinking a lot of booze. They're going to be eating a lot of food.
Can you blame them?
Especially here in Britain. They're going to be putting on a few pounds. Can you give them any tips, just a couple little workout things, perhaps, just to keep that at bay this Christmas?
Well, I don't think that they need to do anything at Christmas time. I think everyone should just enjoy themselves, eat and drink and have a good time. And then after, when New Year comes around, they should set a program of reducing that extra fat that they've gained. But I mean, they just want to have a good time, you know, and for Christmas, so do I.
Okay.
I'm gonna have my Austrian schnapps, I'm gonna ski down the slopes, and I'm gonna have a great time.
So Arnold says, put on weight over Christmas and have lots of booze.
That's it.
have you ever been out of shape in your life? Has there ever been a time in your life when you thought, oh, I've gotta get back down to the gym, I really let myself go?
Well, I think that it's a very difficult thing to answer because in a way, even the day when I won the 7th Mr. Olympia title, I felt like, you know, I was not in great shape. So I was always so hungry for perfection and so hungry for being bigger and better and lifting more and performing better and all those things. I think you need that in order to be successful, in order to really be extraordinary in the profession that you do. If you're happy with just anything, it's not gonna motivate you enough to really work for it. And I think it was a big plus, and I think that all goes back to my childhood.
Yeah.
You know, for growing up in a little place with nothing. Whereas my kids today, grow up much more comfortable with money, with a totally different upbringing, they will most likely never have that drive, that hunger, and that need for being successful.
Okay, now you moved to London. A lot of people don't know this. You moved to London. Why did you come over here originally?
Well, London was the place where the Mr. Universe contest was held.
Well, let's see some memories of your time in London. Have a look at this.
There was this big Austrian boy in a fawn corduroy suit sitting over...
Very short, wasn't it?
Trousers up, halfway up his calves. And I said to Arnold, what's the matter with you, boy? Why are you sitting on your own? He said, I don't know anybody. I said, well, it's all right, son, you know me now. And shook his head. And I said to him, would you like to come over and enter a show and train in my gym?
He was a real hick, you know. He really, he was a young boy from the country. But he used to love to train here because it was the one place that he could really get a pump.
This is the gym where Arnold trained for many of his victories, right? This one here was a favourite of his. Very, very old-fashioned, but very functional. Arnold had a struggle to get into it, but we used to lever him in and then make him do it, okay? Now, on there, we've got probably 30 pounds. When Arnold used to use it, he would use a minimum of 300.
It's one of the most important rooms in the place because this is the feed station for Arnold. It was necessary for him not only to train like a crazy person, as he did, but to be fed every hour. And then always before bedtime, he would go on the scales because the aim was to put a pound on a day. And if that pound hadn't been reached, heaven help me, because that meant more feeding until the goal was achieved. We used to have a bed settee here, big bed settee, which after we'd sat and talked and practiced posing or whatever, we would open and Arnold would sleep here. When we became friendly, he used to come back several times a year to us. Wag would arrange a series of exhibitions around the country for him so that he could earn some money and also promote himself. And of course, he used to do shows for us in Stratford Town Hall or Poplar Civic or whatever. And then the first stop on the route on the tour would be with my mum and dad down in Portsmouth. This is a room that we've made into a small Arnold Schwarzenegger museum. And some of these ancient pieces here are prototypes of pec decks and bench presses and so on, which Arnold used. Here we've got a very young, very large Arnold. This is when he was on a cover of Health and Strength in 67 with Francis Blythe. And you can see the difference and the evolution of the physique here, because these are a slightly older Arnold in the 70s when he went to the States.
I mean, I said to him, Arnold, you know, what are your ambitions? Like I say to all the fellas. He says, I want to be the biggest bodybuilder in the world, the greatest bodybuilder in the world, the richest bodybuilder in the world. I want to live in California. I want to own an apartment block. He said, I want to be a film star, and I want to go into politics. I thought, you silly sod.
How about that? Thank you very much. That was brilliant. How about that?
Now you heard it all. Very nice.
So how did you enjoy Romford, Essex, where you were living there with Wag and Diane?
Well, it was a lot of fun because I loved the directions I always got. You know, you get off in at the airport and you take this bus, you know, to Miles End, and then you take the subway to this station, and then you go to Romford Road, and you walk up to 335 Romford Road. Diane always, we had always a great time, and I really got this great feeling of this is my second family. My first family was in Austria, and my second family, like the new family, was kind of over here in London. So it was really extremely, extremely important for my next move in my career.
Okay, so you really enjoyed it there. Were you very successful with Essex women?
I don't know. Diane can tell you that if I was successful or not, and Wag can tell you.
Diane.
I never like to brag about. Oh,
was he successful with Essex women?
Successful with all women, all time.
How there you are.
Is he very focused in his pulling technique?
He doesn't need to be. He's just a magnet.
He's just a babe magnet. How about that, Arnold?
I was focused in my pulling techniques and in my pumping techniques.
Good English pun.
Very nice, yes.
How did you deal with the language differences when you went to Essex?
Well, it was very
difficult. I have problems there.
You did. For me, that was English. You know, yeah. It was as simple as that. I didn't have anything.
It's similar.
Yeah, I had nothing to compare it with. But I mean, I learned the ways of perfecting the grammar and all those kind of things. So when I went to the United States, it really was important to know that much English, even though I was not good enough yet when I moved to the United States to understand the news or to read the newspaper and to understand everything.
Okay, you were in London at the height of the swinging 60s, if you like. Did you swing? Did you get
I had
thing?
A great time, and I enjoyed, you know, the working out, the hard working out, but I also enjoyed the hard playing. I always enjoyed both my whole life, you know. I mean, I always was the kind of guy that enjoyed working out 5 hours a day, but then when I walk out of the gym, that's it. And I wanted to play, I wanted to have a good time.
Okay. I gather Jimmy Savile fixed it for you. Is that
true? What did he fix?
Apparently, Jimmy Savile was a judge the first year that you won Mr. Universe. He may not even know who Jimmy Savile is, it says down here.
You know who was a judge at the Mr. Universe contest?
Jimmy Savile.
Wag Bennett was a judge
really?
At the
was
Mr.
Jimmy
Universe.
Was Jimmy Savile a judge there? How's about that then, guys?
One year, exactly.
Okay. A lot of big Hollywood names like yourself have moved over to England. Would you ever consider moving over to London and living here?
No.
Never?
Never, no. Because I'm very happy with where I am. I love Southern California. I was born for Southern California. Okay. And I love the energy in Hollywood. I love the danger in Hollywood.
The danger?
The danger, the psychological danger.
Is there some psychological danger? What do you mean?
Well, because every time you, you know, you do something well, you go up, you know, you're like, you feel like in heaven, and then every time you fail, you're as good as your last movie. The press trashes you, the people attack you, and they're nasty about it and all those kind of things. And there's something really interesting about that, because, I mean, I love my movies that I do. I have a great time doing them, but when they're finished, I like them. But there were some real dogs I made, too. I mean, there was no old movie that were perfect.
Well, we'll talk to that in the next bit.
Exactly, I'm sure you will.
Okay, well, in the Arnold Schwarzenegger story, where we are at the moment is you're in Britain. In part two, Arnold arrives in America. Back in a couple of seconds.
I'll be back.
Consider it a divorce.
So when you arrived in America, how confident were you of success there and whatever you did? What was your frame of mind as you arrived there?
Well, my frame of mind was that I knew that it always has been known as the land of opportunities. So it was just a question for me, first of all, to experience that, if that really is true, and then also for me to put the hard work into it. But I went over there, you know, and I was received in America with open arms. I found people and friends that helped me, buying silverware and television sets, and found
when you arrived
apartment.
In America, and people bought you silverware.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, you know, kind of, you got to eat. Yeah. You know, it was not real silver.
I was going to say. I'll have a load of silver. Yes. Welcome to the country. Yes. Yeah. Things have changed.
It was not bad, believe me. But I mean, it was really interesting, the help that I got. But it was then up to me to really make something out of myself. So I first of all joined college right away, Santa Monica City College, to learn English really well and to learn about America, the history of America and all that. That then eventually led to going full-time to college and to go for a business degree and for a degree in economics, which I did on the side of working out, because working out is 5 hours a day, but then, you know, I felt like I should be productive the rest of the day and do something. I even started working as bricklayer to make some extra money. We started a bricklaying business, Franco Colombo, who was another world champion, and myself. So there was a lot of things that I did, and I really experienced that it is the land of opportunities, that one can accomplish anything in America if, in fact, you're willing to work for it and educate yourself and have the drive.
Okay, which you certainly had. You mentioned Franco Colombo. Let's have a look at him here. Here we go.
I know Arnold since 1965, and we met on the stage in a competition. He won the bodybuilding junior Mr. Europe, and I won the European powerlifting championship. When I first came to the United States, we lived in Santa Monica, three blocks from the beach, And we used to live together. We had two bedrooms, a little apartment. And in the morning was like, he was the guy that 6:30 we got up, like a military guy. Arnold was in the military. He knows all the disciplines. He gets up 6:30, Franco, get up, do the protein drink. And I'm going like this, you know, putting the eggs in the protein drink. And then we would go there, drink the protein drink, get in the car and go to the gym. It was like a continuous routine for years and paid off later that we were the best of all times in bodybuilding with no question. When we first met, he talked about him winning Mr. Universe. And when the minute he won Mr. Universe, he won in London in 1967. He says to me, now he's the Mr. Olympia. So he was like projected to say Mr. Olympia. And then when he competed and won Mr. Olympia, his goal was to win it many times, which he won it 7 times. And as he went toward the end of the Mr. Olympia, when he won the 6th time, which was in 1975, we made the movie Pumping Iron. And that is when he started intriguing, says, I'm not going to compete forever. I'm going to go now in another career, which is acting career. At that time, he already made a little movie called Hercules in New York. It was very funny. And then Pumping Iron was like a documentary, and really, we were very known here to the general public. Bodybuilding became more generally known. And then after that, his mind was really on the career of acting.
So there we go.
Were you then confident that you would become a successful actor? Why did you think you could do acting?
I never was comfortable at that point thinking that I was a successful actor. I wanted to make certain steps just, you know, to really get known internationally and to get the big break. And for me, Conan the Barbarian was the big break.
Okay, but this film here, your first feature, Hercules in New York, and in that you're credited as Arnold Strong, which is a great name. Was there pressure to change your name to make it more sort of American?
I was really confused at that time if that was the right thing to do or not. I mean, the producers suggested that and they did it automatically. Yeah. They said, you know, everyone that comes over from Europe and is in show business changes their names, and that's a traditional thing. And that movie then went in the toilet. I mean, it didn't go anywhere. It made $3. And so I said to myself, hey, it couldn't be the name changing that could make you a success. Yeah. So I went back to the Schwarzenegger name, you know, and then tried it again. I didn't even use my own voice in that movie.
It was dubbed, wasn't it?
It was dubbed because I couldn't even understand the script. I mean, I just moved to America. You know, I mean, I read the script. I really didn't understand what the hell I was reading. But it was a great experience. It was one of those dream stories, you know, where you just read about it. You go to Hollywood and you get discovered. That's exactly what happened. I was there 6 months, and then all of a sudden, I got this offer to star in a Hercules movie.
Okay, let's have a look at a clip of it now. Here we go.
A very good throw for one who is earthbound.
Skip the wisecracks. Put your money where your mouth is.
I do not have any money.
I mean, stop talking. Demonstrate.
All right.
There we go, thank you. What do you think is your favorite role that you've done so far?
Well, I think that Terminator, Twins, True Lies, and now I have to say End of Days also, because End of Days, obviously, because of the complexity of the character that I've played.
Okay. Are there any roles you wish you hadn't played? Big cough.
I would say that there were several movies that that failed. And but at the same time, I have to say that I did not regret making any of them, because at the time they all sounded good. Mm. At the time, the media all seemed like they were great career moves. You know, it's always easy to be smart in hindsight. Yeah. And to look back and say that was a mistake, but it doesn't help you. I mean, I think the important thing really is to learn from those mistakes and then to move forward in a better way and in a smarter way. Because to me, you know, life is short, and you want to pack in as much as you can while you live, rather than just exist.
Okay. Now, about your rivalry with Sylvester Stallone. It's a legendary rivalry. I spoke to Sly a couple of years ago, and he said he offered you a cameo role in the film Judge Dredd. And you said to him, save it for the team-up.
Well, Sly is absolutely correct. He did offer me that, and so did I offer him parts sometimes. And we said that we should wait for the opportunity when there is a perfect script available, a script like The Dirty Dozen.
Duo.
Exactly. No, but I mean, you know, those movies where you have like a bunch of the top guys get together and do a movie
but
together.
But why do they do those anymore?
Well, I think it is just the financing is just so difficult. But, you know, as I said, you know, I'm the first one to say I would do it for free because, you know, none of us needs the cash. So it's doable. But the fact of the matter is we are always looking for a project to do, not just him and me together, but also with other guys.
Who'd be your Dirty Dozen then? Who'd be your modern Dirty Dozen?
I think that, you know, Kevin Costner I would like to work with. I think he's just
terrific. You, Kevin, Sly.
And yeah, Sly will be one of them. I think that, you know, DiCaprio is an interesting character to have in that mix because he's so different. He's
not I can see that. You're selling it.
The traditional, you know, action hero. So there's a lot of this, you know, Nicolas Cage is terrific. Yeah. Tom Hanks, Tom Cruise, all of those guys will make a really interesting team because everyone has their own fans and everyone has their own kind of qualities that they bring to the screen.
I don't think anyone will be able to afford the wage bill at the very start, though, so it wouldn't have to be back
in. I think that everyone can afford it. Look, if they can afford
it... No, you're 20 million a movie,
each of
you. No,
I said for free. Everyone does it for free.
All right.
That's what I said. It's really, at that point of the game, we are at such an enormous level of money that it doesn't really matter. Plus, I never feel guilty for the money I get anyway. I mean, I just love it when they have to dish it out.
Yeah.
You know, the studio executives. So, but I mean, I think that Sly will be great. I mean, I have always been, even though there was a certain rivalry always there.
Which were you friendly ever, though?
We were friendly. Sly and I always was friendly.
So you always played it up?
We always respected each other. It's just that the press loved to create a certain kind of animosity amongst them.
I wanted to see a film where it was you v him in a jungle.
Exactly, that's exactly what
that's what
is.
I want.
Yeah, exactly.
You and him, mano a mano, with big guns
exactly,
and massive
armor
up sequences, knives going into socks. And
that's right, exactly.
Sorry, I've completely lost it there, aren't I?
No, it's good. As a matter of fact, you should be in a Dirty Dozen, too.
You just convinced
me the way you got into the character. Yeah, exactly, very nice.
I'm your man.
All you have to do is build a little tricep and you got
it.
Free.
I used to be hideously overdeveloped. What happens if you keep going? It goes back in.
Nice.
Yeah, nice. Okay. How do you think people will look back on that whole action era? I mean, it was so packed with violent films, and we had, you know, Chuck Norris, Van Damme, Mel Gibson, Steven Seagal, Dolph Lundgren, Sly Stallone, I mean, Bruce Willis, millions of them. What do you think gave rise to that action explosion, if you like? It is an extraordinary era.
Well, I think that it was clear that there was a tremendous need for those movies in the 80s and in the
early 90s. Where did that need stem from, though? What did you want from that?
I think that the need stems from that partially because I think of the women's liberation. I think that the women's liberation had a lot to do with it because they have, men have felt, especially in America, to a certain extent powerless because women kind of have taken over the power. And I think that there was a reaction to that. But now, of course, it has changed because now the people are back kind of to a normal situation where women realize, you know, that it's not just about going out and getting the equal job and the equal pay and all this, that there's something also nice about being a woman and being in touch with being a woman and raising a family and make that the ultimate challenge because women have not really made themselves ultimately happy with all the kind of things that they have tried. And I think that I was the benefactor of all of those things in a way of, you know, the guys felt very insecure about all that stuff. They all ran to the action movies where they could see a guy kicking butt and being in total control of himself and the situation, which they felt they were not.
You went to the US, you became, I would say, astoundingly rich, very famous, you married a Kennedy. Did you ever sort of sit back and in your bed and just think, you know, God bless America, this place has been really good to me?
Well, I mean, I would say that, as I said, America is the land of opportunities. Mm. You know, I think that if you're willing to do something, you can do it. And, you know, America has opened up its arms, it has given me the opportunities. I don't think that this career would have been possible if I would have tried it in any other country in the world.
We spoke about your wife there, Maria. Now, she comes from, obviously, the most famous liberal family, if you like, in America, the Kennedys. Do you not talk politics at home? Because I know you're not a Democrat. Do you never raise the subject of politics at
home?
Well,
people always think that, you know, we have a lot of arguments because of politics.
We like to think that.
Yeah, the fact of the matter is we really don't.
Really?
Especially since I've been sleeping in the garage.
Yeah.
No, but I tell you one thing that, you know, when I got married, one of the things that you say in front of the altar is, I take this woman in sickness and in health. Being a Democrat and being a liberal is her sickness. Right. So I accept it completely, so it makes the difference.
Okay. What about in Hollywood generally? I mean, do you feel a bit of an outsider there? Hollywood is another place, a very liberal and democratic place. Do you feel an outsider there because of your politics ever?
Well, first of all, you have to understand my mentality. I love feeling like an outsider. I never want to be one of a million. If I wanted to be one of a million, I would have never got the body that I got. Okay. If I wanted to be one of a million, I would have never wanted to become the biggest star in the world and be in that very exclusive group of guys, you know, that make, you know, the kind of money that we make and all those things. So to me, it is very it's very attractive, you know, to be in Hollywood, which is 90% liberals, and then to be a conservative politician, meaning conservative with a social conscience.
Right.
That's the most important thing, because there's also conservative politicians that don't give a damn about, you know, what people do and think and
tell me about
how much money
English.
they make. No, there's certain politicians. I'm not saying all. There's certain in America that I don't like, and because I feel like, you know, you can have be fiscally conservative in politics, but be responsible for people at the same time and help those that need help. And that's what we have to do, no matter if you're a politician or if you're just an ordinary citizen.
Okay, thank you very much. Do you know what? This is the end of part two. In part three, we'll be talking about Arnie's latest release, The End of Days. Don't go away.
Hasta la vista, baby.
Consider it a divorce.
So why have you waited so long to do a film since Batman and Robin?
Well, it isn't really that long. It's 2.5 years. I mean, it's like, you know, I find it more important to pick the right script and the right story and the right project rather than just to go to work. And also, I felt very strongly that, you know, after my heart surgery, it was very important that I come back with a big bang, with a big movie. They didn't want to come out with a little movie, so everyone in the press says, you know, you see, he cannot do the stunts anymore, he has trouble to do the big movies, he cannot be hired for a big movie and all those things. Everything that you do when you're in the public limelight like that, you know, you have to think about all of those things rather than just yourself.
Does criticism hurt you when you read it?
It doesn't hurt me. I read some of it, and then sometimes it has an effect on me and sometimes not, but it's all part of it. You cannot be under the microscope as I am and not have some people dislike the movies that I do, dislike the politics that I have, dislike the things that I do and say. I mean, it's natural that there's always a certain percentage of people that are disliking the things that you do and say and the movies that you make and so on.
But they've got to like the fact that you actually speak your mind.
I speak my mind all the time, and, you know, they may like it, but then, you know, I know that as a whole, I have done a great job with my image and with the movies that I've done.
Well,
and that is
the
bottom line to me.
It just interests me that just how I see you shifting in your career and how aware you seem to be of your profile. You know, you're there as an action hero who's capable of playing baddies, something I wish actually you'd done more of. Really enjoy seeing you play a baddie. And then you switch to Twins, which is a big step, because it could have undermined you as an action hero to suddenly do this comedy where you're effectively becoming a self-parody. And you go to things like Total Recall, which kind of gave you that, I felt, more credibility than ever.
Well, I think that it is important that you play the part that you are. I mean,
but how are you so self-aware of what you're standing as and how people perceive you?
Well, I know that I have a sense of humor. So therefore, I wanted to see that on the screen.
Well, it was lucky because it was actually your biggest grossing film up to then was Twins. It took more than all your action films.
Absolutely Twins. And so the comedies became a big thing because people all of a sudden said, wait a minute, we are enjoying him also in a movie that is a comedy, yeah. Not just to blow up the buildings and the people and all those kind of things.
No, they love that as well.
Slater! Don't even think it, Slater, you hear me? You're gonna sit and wait for the real hostage negotiator. God damn it, Jack, I'm talking to you. The last time you pulled this John Jitterbug popcorn antique, people lost body parts. Now you go in there, and it's your badge.
Jack, I know as mayor of this great metropolis, you and I have had our little tiss, but this is the lieutenant governor.
Slater, here's what I...
When the governor gets here, call me.
Slater's attempting to enter. Do not let him in. Repeat, do not let him in.
Piece of cake.
Hey, you want to be a farmer? Here's a couple of acres. Decker, the next one I'll hurt.
I mean, you're talking about how you change. I mean, in this, End of Days, you're playing a much more flawed character than we've ever seen before. It starts off, you're suicidal, you're an alcoholic. Did you enjoy playing that? Did you enjoy that switch to being vulnerable instead of kind of invincible?
I loved playing the character of Jericho in End of Days. I think it was terrific. I thought it was great. It was well written because I started suicidal, and you don't know in the beginning of the movie what the outcome is going to be. You don't know if I'm the hero or not.
No.
Am I going to be possessed by the devil
because I'm so vulnerable? You were
right,
yeah.
Exactly. So it has a lot of twists and people that they like to have interesting stories where you can think all the way through. Rather than being told in the first, act of who is the hero and who is the villain.
Well, so you've got him here as kind of, I mean, it could be a coincidence that in End of Days, the devil is a Wall Street banker. And in a recent film, Devil's Advocate, remember, Al Pacino was a lawyer as Satan. Right. Can we assume Satan is a white-collar professional?
He could be, he could also be, an agent.
I'd favor that as an answer.
I was hanging out with my agent a lot before I did the shooting of the movie to get used to hanging out with the devil. Yeah. But no, but I think that it was a really good idea to have him be a banker, a sleazy banker, that was played by Gabriel Byrne, who did a terrific job.
He's
unbelievable in his strength and all that stuff. It was really well played. So
but he's quite relaxed as well. He's not sort of in your face evil. He's actually quite a charming sort of chap.
He's terrific because he can turn on the charm in the movie when he wants to seduce the girl. Because the important part is that he's looking for his bride that he has picked 20 years ago, and there's this great birth in the beginning of the film, and then 20 years later he comes back and he's looking for her. And he doesn't quite know where she is. He just knows who it is, but he doesn't know where she is. And then eventually when he finds her, the seduction he puts on there is really unbelievable. Yeah.
Why do you think the spawn of Satan is always American-born these days?
Well, I mean, what do you want him to do? I mean, you couldn't have him be born in London and come out of the River Thames. Because there's nothing alive coming out of that river anyway, as far as...
Well, no, actually, 2 years ago, they got a salmon out of there. I think they put it in, but...
I love that.
Apparently, there was a salmon in there.
No, but you're one. That's a record. We should put it in the Guinness Book of World Records.
I think it might be in there.
No, but, I mean, I think it is because, New York is obviously the center of financial power. And what one assumes is that is already the financial, the Wall Street, and all this manipulation worldwide is already possessed by the devil. So that's why the story lends itself to use a bank and to use someone that is sleazy, and one would assume that whole industry is like that.
Okay, now you spoke earlier about the heart problems you had, the heart operation you had. Did that sort of make you reflect on your own mortality, perhaps? And is that why this film is such a sort of different film to the ones that have gone before?
No, I mean, I think that I knew that I'm vulnerable. I mean, vulnerable to injuries, vulnerable to illnesses and all those things. Also, to me, the heart problem was no surprise because my entire family, on my mother's side, had that problem. You know, my grandmother died of the same problem because of a valve problem. My mother refused to have the operation, and she just said, when God calls me, he should have me. I don't want to have a surgery. And so I did not want to go that direction, and I wanted to fix it.
But you're always aware you had that kind of, if you like, a genetic time bomb kind of ticking.
Yeah, I always knew that was our problem. Each family has their own little medical history. And that was ours. You know, that was on my mother's side. So I knew that. So it was not really a big surprise. It's just, you never like an operation like that because there's still a chance there that you may never wake up. And that really would have pissed me off, believe me.
Yeah. I bet.
Oh, I would have been really mad.
Well, if you died, you'd be mad.
Exactly. Mad in heaven.
Yeah. Just raging in heaven.
Raging. Yeah.
God help him.
Exactly.
How does it affect what sort of stunts and things you do on set now?
I think that one of the things, like I said earlier, it was important for me to do a big film like this to show that I can't do the same stunts. I can run as fast. I can have the energy. And then also, as you know, the stunts are dangerous. You know, you deal with fire in this movie. You deal with jumping out of helicopters and rappelling down on, you know, and all those kind of things, and being run over by a train and all. So there's certain things you do with visual effects, but other things you have to actually do it, and in order to be believable. So my wife worries about it many times, and my kids.
Well, knowing your mentality as well of pushing it.
Exactly, always pushing the limit.
I think if I was a relative of yours, I'd be worried.
Right, and that's why also when I bring the kids to the set and have them do their homework and hang out with me on the set, I don't bring them when I usually do scenes like that, or that appear to be dangerous, because I don't want them to worry about it.
You are 52 now.
Yeah.
Sorry, everybody.
That's okay. Looking like a stud.
Yeah. Thank you. How much longer can you be an action hero, do you think?
Well, it really depends. I mean, we have just seen recently Sean Connery in one, and, you know, he's 70 or something.
I think he's better, actually.
And he's fantastic. I think Clint Eastwood did action movies in his 60s. I think you can do it. It depends, you know, what kind of a physical shape you're in. And also, you know, I'm not obsessed about the fact of staying in the action genre. If there's a time where that doesn't work as well, I can go over to other things, you know. And I think it would be a very interesting challenge, because why always do the same thing? I think you do the things as long as you think it can entertain people. When you feel like that this doesn't entertain people anymore, or that you maybe are too old for this, I can't even imagine I'm saying that. I was just recently 19 years old, and now I'm sitting here talking about, it could be that I'm too old someday. But anyway.
It feels like that, does it?
I don't feel like that. I mean, I feel as young as I, you know, when I was 30. I mean, I'm full of energy and I can do all the physical things. But I say, should I get to that stage, you know, then I just change over, because, or maybe just stop completely with the whole thing, because, you know.
Is there something you enjoy about getting older?
I don't enjoy anything about getting older. No, I think.
Frankly, nothing. Apart from family.
Getting old is not for wimps, that I can tell you.
Okay.
So, I mean, it's the very thought.
I think it's right up your street then.
Well, no, exactly. It's the very thought about you know, even let's assume you get to be 150 years old.
That's you've got plans, haven't you? You've got something at home, I
exactly.
think.
A little cloning?
Yeah. Is that what you'll do?
No, but let's assume, still, each year you live, it's 1 year less, no matter what age you're going to become, you know? So that is kind of annoying, I think. And I think that you do think about that when you get to be over 50, unlike that when you're 30, and you never think about it.
Mm. Okay. And lastly, you know, the ambition you listed, you know, last of all, when we were talking about your ambitions when you were a 15-year-old in Austria, was going into politics. Do you still plan to get into politics somehow? What would be your step into that as the next bit of the Schwarzenegger story?
Well, it was not really my ambition then. It was my ambition was when I was 15 to become, you know, a star and an actor and make big money.
But when you're in Romford, you told this gentleman here politics was there.
I mean anything. Why not? But I mean, I think that my need today really is much more just helping people. You know, I think that I've in the last.
Come 15, on, when are you going to run?
15 years.
You've done everything else on the list that he said. Don't give me this last one was just thrown in because I don't think you throw anything in gratuitously. When are you going to do it?
I do not have a plan. I don't have a plan.
Really?
I don't. I mean, my plan is right now to work with people, and because I think that politicians are falling short with the things that they are doing. I think that every time. You know, there are things going well in the country, they point their finger at themselves and say, we did it, this party did it, I did it, and all that. And then if there's a social ill in the country, and there's a shooting in a school or something like that, they point their fingers at Hollywood or at rock and roll music or at video games and all of those kind of things. It's, you know, it's a sick world, I mean, and then that's a problem why politicians, you know, are not being trusted. And you know, when you read the statistics about who are the least trusted people, you know, politicians rank right along
number
those,
one, aren't they?
Those lists, and it's sad, you know, and I think so. Therefore, I think we all have anyway a responsibility in society to help one another. And so, what I can do with the power that I've gained in the entertainment business, the power of influence over young kids, is it gives me a pleasure to then use that power on those kids. And tell them, stay away from drugs, stay away from the violence, stay away from gangs, and go and educate yourself. And the more you help people, the more you see the social ills, and the more you want to get involved in even more. So it can just show you how many millions of people you can affect without running for office. So that's why I really don't know if that will lead to it or not.
I want you to vote. At the same time, send a message to Congress. At the same time, send a message to Pat Buchanan. Hasta la vista, baby. Thank you. Thank you very much. See you all, okay? I count on you on Tuesday. Bye.
Okay, last question. Are you a fan of British beef?
mean because you had the problem with the beef?
No, just generally, just the taste. Forget the politics, the taste of British beef.
I have my beef over in America, and I have my beef when I go to Germany, it's the German beef. When I come to England, I have the English beef, so it doesn't make any difference. I mean, as long as it's good.
You're going to do well in politics with an answer like that. Arnold Schwarzenegger, thank you very much for talking to me.
Thank you.